Well, hello everyone, and welcome back to the Amazing Spider Talk. My name is Dapper Dan Gavosnin.
And I am, of course, mischievous Mark Giannacchio.
And Mark, we are joined today for, a more somber affair, although certainly this seems to be, 2018 seems to be the year of kind of somber affairs in regards to Spider-Man and its creators.
Yeah, we're here, and obviously we'll be talking about the recent passing of Stan Lee, the co-creator of Spider-Man, and really he's much more than the co-creator of just Spider-Man. I mean, he was the big bang of Marvel Comics, as the guest that we'll be joined with in a bit will be discussing at length. But, just in terms of what had happened, Stan Lee died on November 12th. He was at Cedar Sinai Medical Center. He was 95 years old, Dan. I mean, a really great, great full life. He was buried privately very recently. And of course, we lost Steve Ditko, the other co-creator of Spider-Man, earlier this year. But, Ditko, for the better part of the last few decades, has kind of lived a more reclusive life, whereas Stan, to the very, very end, I feel, was still very much in the public image. I mean, unfortunately, some of the more recent news reports regarding him and his life weren't always the most pleasant things, I think, we as fans to read about. But, I mean, Stannis has always just been this fixture in pop culture and in media. I mean, for as long as I've been alive, and you as well, obviously, Dan, and predating us, the last two seasons of Amazing Spider Talk have dealt extensively with Stan's work on the character for the first season, obviously him and Ditko. And we have a great interview with a writer of a Stan biography. The writer's name is Bob Batchelor. So that episode, it's season one, episode six, Excelsior or Excedrin. So that talks a lot about Stan's career and influence. And then, again, in the Ditko and Romita centric episodes that we did in season one and two, we kind of talk about the Stan's dynamic with the artist there. Stan's fingerprints are all over our work for certain, Dan.
Yeah, right. So today, I don't want to get too deep into those details. Let's start off, Mark. Let's talk about who was Stan to us, because truly we can't speak to a deep relationship with Stan. Like, I don't know if you've ever met Stan. I met him a handful of times, but I can't say to have an actual relationship with the man. And so I think the better thing to do is to talk about, who was Stan to us and how did we react to the news of his passing. So, Mark, why don't you start off with you? What is Stan to you?
I mean, it's just so funny because, and again, we'll talk about this in a little bit with our guests, but, Stan was just so much more myth than anything else to me. I mean, I never got to meet him, but he was obviously just kind of a part of my life. I mean, for as long as I was reading comics, for certain, and even predating it. I mean, I've talked about this to some degree. I mean, my first interaction with comics was actually, it was a combination of the Saturday morning cartoons, and then it was like the Secret Wars action figures from the early and mid 1980s. And, of course, at that point, I didn't know necessarily who Stan Lee was. And even when I started reading Spider-Man, I don't know if I knew who Stan Lee was. But as I became more and more of a fan, it was this figurehead of who this person was who created all this. And Dan, probably to your dismay, even back when I was younger, I always kind of gave the writers and the editors more credit than the artists. Except for Todd McFarlane. That was the one exception. But I mean, for the most part, I always thought of Stan as the guy. He was, and that's the way he presented himself. I mean, and it wasn't to the discredit, I feel, of the Ditkos and the Kirbys and the Romitas and everyone else who worked alongside Stan. But every time I'd see him on TV or in an interview, I mean, his cameo in Mallrats, the Kevin Smith movie, which was, probably the crudest you'll ever have Stan Lee in a mass produced piece of media, for certain. He seemed both so relatable, but also so otherworldly and mythological. I think that's the dichotomy that just makes him as a person just so extraordinary, because like he did just seem like this genuine kind of a schlub, you know, for lack of a better word. I mean, like, he just seemed, you know, like kind of a carny, but like, I don't know. I had no, like, I didn't distrust him or anything, but you know, like I'm terrible with words right now, Dan, but you know, when I heard of his passing, you know, I think in some way, I think Ditko's death set me up for this. Like, I was legit shocked when Ditko died, even though Ditko was only 5 years younger than Stan. It's not like there was a major age gap there. So I think that kind of like almost in its own way kind of prepared me for this, like, you know, this idea that these larger than life kind of mythological figures related to this medium that I love so much might be going. But it still just kind of seemed jarring, because it's like the idea of, you know, Stan has just been so ingrained in as a part of who I am and what I love, that, like, you know, I mean, he might have died, but I don't think he's gone. Does that make sense?
Yeah, absolutely.
What about with you? I mean, how did you feel? I mean, what's your take on what happened?
It's really hard, like you said, for me to know how to feel about it, because you're right. Like, Stan was part of everything that I loved as well, you know, and still love, you know, like, whether it's opening up comics for decades, it says Stan Lee presents, you know, This guy was everywhere. And I, for the life of me, can't recall what it was like to first kind of learn about Stan Lee and learn who he was, because he was everywhere. Like, I can't imagine me knowing comics without Stan Lee, even though I got in, like you said, in like the 300 something issues, you know, like where Stan very much wasn't a part of that. But then there were, you know, the 90s cartoons, the Fantastic Four show and Spider-Man show, where he would do, you know, introductions to every episode or something, you know, and it was, this guy just was everywhere. There was no escape from him, and you didn't want to escape from him, because he was often the highlight of all these things, or he was the guy that brought the myth and the value to things, you know. He was the guy that made it a legend beyond just kind of a fluke, and I quickly associated him with that, and I couldn't tell you why, other than just kind of the pure enjoyment of his voice, his candor, his language, and some of the comics that I was reading. You know, like, you couldn't get away from Stan. And, you know, since his death, I've really been thinking about that a lot. You know, even Stan Lee is not his real name. He was Stanley Lieber.
Right.
And he was initially ashamed to kind of put his real name on comics, because he always thought that he would be the guy writing the great American novel. And that never really came true for him. But instead of writing, you know, like the great American novel or a story, he created something even greater. He created myth. And to the point that his name is Stan Lee now, unashamedly. Like, that is his name, you know? Like, what became a disguise became his new reality. And I just think there's a lot to be kind of gained from that. The idea that you kind of work with what you got and you do your best where you're at, and, you know, that can be enough or more than enough for anyone. And that's kind of what I've been thinking about, you know, in his death, is the kind of beyond the characters he created or the industry that he revolutionized, is just, you know, like, him as a human being, like, what was it like to kind of do that, and what are the lessons I take away from him as a person beyond being like a good person and espousing good moral values? Our friend of the show, Alan Scherstel, wrote a really great piece, you know, and it basically said, you know, that his comics were revolutionary, but what we can really take away from Stan is like that he was a living embodiment of his moral code, you know, the idea that with great power must also come great responsibility. This guy put his moralizing into his comics, the Stan Lee soapboxes. In comics, we see them today as a big cultural, you know, force, but back then they were something disposable. And even then he felt the need that it was a value to espouse morals and push for against bigotry and things like that. And I find that really moving. Like this guy, even in his own limited realm, wanted to find a way to influence the minds and lives of other people to make them better. And, you know, I don't know what else, like how you even begin to sum up who Stan Lee is to me, because it's so infected every element of everything that I care about. So I don't know. I was very sad the day that he passed, and not even directly through the man, but through like the, it seems like the end of an era. And I spent the whole day just reading articles about him and hoping to get any anecdote that I could, you know, out of Stan, because we're not likely to have that big of an outpouring of stories about him ever again. Maybe when a movie comes out about his life or something, but I was wanting to soak that up as much as I could.
At the same time, like, it does feel like we've heard a lot of the stories. I mean, when you read the interviews that Stan gave, I mean, I did a lot of reading of interviews when I was writing the book a couple summers ago. I mean, it's a lot of it, and I don't say this as to be derogatory, but a lot of this is the same stuff over and over again. I mean, like, you know, it's like he, and we'll get into this in our conversation in a little bit, but like he kind of embodies in his truest sense of who he is, the mythology of who he is. And I don't know if there is anyone else out there that's existed that kind of captured it quite that way. You know, it's truly something extraordinary, for lack of a better word. I don't know how else to put it. I just feel like you're not going to see someone like Stan Lee. I don't think you're going to see someone like Stan Lee ever again. I don't know. I mean, and I'm not just talking about but just like in terms of the alignment of pop culture in this fashion. I mean, I think he's that important and that distinct in terms of who he was and how he presented himself and how he sold himself and just the whole thing.
It's hard to put a value or any kind of like meter on his influence when the very words that I speak, the kind of language that I use, came directly from him, you know, like reading his comics where he's putting SAT words in every other word, you know, like I have to think that so much of my interest in vocabulary and writing and being an intellectual came from a grounding in his comics of all places, you know, and what, how do you value that? There is no value for that. It's just, it's a cultural force, like you said. And I was thinking like, how do you, you know, measure him up to others like you said, you know? Like, I was thinking about Steven Spielberg. I would consider him the greatest working filmmaker. And he certainly changed cinema, you know, as we know it. You know, he turned the blockbuster. But we would still have cinema without, you know, Steven Spielberg. I don't feel like we would have comics, especially superhero comics, in the same way that we have them without Stan Lee. Like it's hard to even consider.
And I don't even think like the biggest fans of Spielberg have the same kind of emotional relationship that fans of comics and fans of Marvel comics specifically had with Stan Lee. I think that's the other kind of defining trait here. There was just something so magnetic that made you feel like, not that you necessarily knew him, but like, he was just every bit a part of it as the characters themselves, you know, like he was in essence his greatest creation. Yeah, as we've been seeing.
That kind of upbeat personality of inclusivity and passion, I think for a lot of people, he became emblematic of those character traits. You know, like he was more than a man. He was like ideals, you know, like you looked at this guy and said like, this guy loves what he does. I could only hope to love what I do, you know, to even a tenth of the degree of who Stan Lee is. And in that way, like I said on my Twitter that like, I felt like my grandfather had died, but it's beyond that. It's like, I kind of feel like this passion for a person like that embodies a passion for comics and loving of comics passed away as like an emotional range.
Yeah. Well, Dan, as we've been alluding to throughout this intro here, we're actually going to be joined by a friend of the show, Gerry Conway. He's going to talk a little bit about, you know, not just his personal relationship with Stan, but, you know, just his thoughts on a lot of the things that we've been kind of opining about here. I think it's a great conversation. Gerry says things probably better than we've been rambling on about, right?
I mean, I think this is one of the hardest conversations you and I could have on the show, is like, what do we say about Stan Lee? You know, like,
yeah.
I just don't know what to say. But it's clearly important enough. Like, I don't know about you, but I got text messages all day long from family members and friends saying, I'm really sorry for your loss, which is kind of bizarre. Like,
yeah.
Like a third person, you know, they know I don't have a relationship with him, but they know I would be that sad and that impacted by his loss.
Yeah, I mean, the same here, Dan. I got text messages. I was getting tagged and stuff on Facebook. I was having people say, I had someone say to me, you were the first person I thought of when I saw this news. And I'm like, really? and I'm quite touched by that. But at the same time, it just goes to show, right? I mean,
maybe we're just really vocal.
I guess so.
Well, speaking of which, let's get to our interview with none other than Gerry Conway.
We get, again, the fans love your sense of humor, and you know, it's...
Well, it's an equal love fest, because I love my fans. I cannot tell you how much I love my fans. They, sometimes at night, I'm sitting here, and I'm thinking, what's it all about, you know? And then I get a letter from a fan, or I read something, or I see something, or I remember something, and I realize it's so lucky to have fans who really care about you. And that's the reason I care so much about the fans, because they make me feel so great. And there's something, if you think about it, that is wonderful about somebody caring about you as I care about them, whom you've never met, who may live in another part of the world, but they care, and you have something in common, and occasionally you contact each other. And this business of fans, I think, is terrific. And I love them all.
Well, Dan, we're being joined here for this episode once again by none other than Gerry Conway. Gerry, thank you so much for coming on the show.
Always a pleasure, guys.
Well, Gerry, obviously, I mean, in addition to being a figurehead in the comic book industry for decades, you know, one of your big distinctions in your career was you were the first regular writer to follow the Stan Lee run on Amazing Spider-Man. So, you know, what better person to come on to talk a little bit about Stan's legacy to our Spider-Man fans here? You know, we might have talked to you a little bit about this when we first had you on a couple years ago. But in case we didn't get to the meat of it, I did want to ask you a little bit about when you did start writing at Marvel, and specifically when you took over this Spider-Man from Stan. I mean, what was kind of the relationship you had with Stan at that point? I mean, was he more of like a mentor, or just kind of a figurehead who would float in and out of the offices? I mean, what was kind of the dynamic there from your end?
Well, when I first came to Marvel, Stan hadn't yet made his new deal to be publisher of the company, so he was still editor in chief. And as such, you know, he oversaw the books, read all of the books, and made comments and directed them. But The day-to-day work that I did was with Roy Thomas, who was Stan's assistant at the time, and became more and more hands-on as Stan, you know, relinquished some of those duties. I'd say that initially, you know, I was just in a state of awe. And any time that I was in Stan's presence, I guess I was kind of reduced to a fanboy. And in that kind of a circumstance, you don't really take in very much other than, I don't know, just a generalized anxiety to make him happy with my work. And he seemed to be, you know, I mean, after an initial reluctance to take me on, they fairly quickly, you know, made me a fairly regular part of the operation. So we got along, you know, I mean, I think of him at that time as more like a godfather than a father figure, you know, more like an uncle rather than, you know, someone who was directly overseeing me, an avuncular presence.
You wrote this wonderful personal essay, I guess, on your blog that
yes.
I'll link to in the show notes for this episode that I recommend all of our listeners go and read. And you wrote in that essay that, in effect, Stan, like, helped to, like, quote, create you. Could you talk a little bit about that?
Sure. I mean, we are created by the influences in our lives, you know, and how we respond to those influences. As I said in my post, I encountered Fantastic Four when I when I was about 9 years old, which, you know, that's beginning of middle school. That's the beginning of your real search for identity and self. And that book and the Marvel bullpen behind it, you know, sort of became an opening into a whole new world, you know, of possible career choices, possible way of living. You know, before that, I was always a geek and a nerd and liked reading to the exclusion of, you know, normal activities. But I didn't have any idea of what that could mean, you know, how that could, you know, function as part of my life. But reading Fantastic Four and then realizing that there were people behind the creation of these things that I really loved, you know, that gave me a direction in life. You know, it gave me something to shoot for. And Stan's voice as a writer, his interests as a writer were very accessible to me, you know, as a 9-year-old at the time when I was developing my own sense of what kind of writer I wanted to be. I, you know, if Stan had never come along, I don't think that I would have not been a writer, but, you know, I might have gone more heavily into science fiction as a, you know, science fiction stories and novels as I dabbled in, you know, in my teens. I might have made that more of a career. I think I may have pushed earlier and further into being in film and television. Comics became, you know, my art form of choice, and that was almost exclusively because of, you know, the influence that Stan had on me. So he basically created who I am, for better or worse.
And when you started writing regularly in comics, I mean, did you kind of just unknowingly or knowingly pick up on certain Stanisms in your writing? I mean, were there things that you did where you tried to distinguish yourself from Stan? I mean, you know, yes, you were created by him, but, you know,
sure,
we're all rebels to our parents, right? I mean, absolutely. So
the biggest influence that Stan had on my work was, a sense of melodrama, obviously, and a very strong sense of character, which, you know, when you go back and read these books today, they aren't that heavily character driven, because, you know, that was a different time and a different level of depth. But it was a direction. You know, it pointed a direction that you could go. I think I took it further than Stan did. I tried to go deeper than Stan was interested in going. You know, I took what I felt were the logical next steps or the emotional next steps for how to present these characters and their problems. Stan opened the door. He said, you know, these are real people with real emotions who are acting based on those emotions, which was not really the way that comics had been set up before that. You know, before that, you know, you had superheroes whose primary emotion was to catch the bad guy. I mean, that was it. You know, I mean, Batman was probably the deepest character, and they really didn't play with his motivations at all prior to the 70s, let's say. So Stan actually gave you the idea that character motivations and character arcs were important to writing comic book stories. Like I say, I think I took it much further than Stan would have done. You know, I don't think Stan would have, if Stan had killed off Gwen Stacy, for example, I don't think that it would have been as traumatic. You know, it wouldn't have been as complicated, you know, in terms of cause and effect. And it wouldn't have had as much resonance and consequence in Peter's life from that time forward. I mean, I think it would have always been there, but it wouldn't have been like a driving story force the way I tried to make it. Mm. So in that sense, I think I rebelled from Stan, from Stan's influence, just simply to carry it further, to carry what he had set into motion further than he probably was comfortable or would have been comfortable doing.
Because of the inherently limited focus of our show, we, you know, always look at things from the kind of Spider-Man perspective and discussing Stan through the lens of Spider-Man and his work on the various, you know, titles that he's worked on over the years in that regard. But, you know, to look at Stan in that aspect would be to really ignore, you know, his overall contributions to comics. One of the other things is Mark and I weren't around in the 60s to really kind of see what it was like to kind of suddenly experience Stan's effect on not only comics but pop culture in general. I wonder, could you speak about, like, what was it like being that 9-year-old boy and discovering Stan Lee? You know, like, so many of these fads come and kids get obsessed with them and then they go, but somehow we're still talking about Stan Lee 50 plus years later.
Yeah, 60 you know, years later almost.
60
yeah.
Years, yeah. Yeah.
Well, I think I think it was a comparable thing would be the Beatles, you know, in a very real sense. You know, rock and roll existed before the Beatles. Pop culture and pop music existed before the Beatles. But the impact that the Beatles had was so revolutionary on almost every aspect of music in the 60s that today you cannot really imagine music without the Beatles. You know, you can kind of imagine music without Chuck Berry. It'd be very hard, but, you know, you kind of can. But even though the Beatles only were around for, like, as a pop culture active force for about 8 years, you know, from about 62 to 70 when they broke up, they influenced an entire generation of creators that followed them. And that's what Stan did. I mean, comic books prior to Stan were specifically aimed at young kids. I met Julie Schwartz when I was about 14 years old, 15 years old, and I met him at DC Comics at one of their tours. And Julie was having a conversation with some other fan and was trying to make a point. You know, he was trying to make a point about the readership. And he turned around and he looked around and he saw me in this crowd. And he said, "You, how old are you?" I said, "I'm 14. I think I was 14 at the time." He said, "Oh, you're too old." Literally, as far as Julie was concerned, his readership were 10-year-olds to 13-year-olds. And that every 3 years, he had an entirely new group of readers. So they recycled stories. They recycled ideas. They recycled everything, you know, because they felt like they had a completely new readership every 3 years. Stan, on the other hand, perceived the idea of an ongoing readership that potentially could stay with the books forever. I don't think that that's what he had it as a conscious idea, but he was writing for an audience that extended from 10 years old through 25, 30 years old. And nobody had done that. I mean, literally nobody had written for an older audience over the age of 13. You know, even EC Comics, which was the most mature series of stories, you know, books prior to the Marvel comics. I think their maximum age that they were aiming at was maybe 15-year-old kids. You know, they did the gross out horror comics. They did the smack you in the face with a fish comedy comics. They did, you know, some noirish light type suspense comics, but they didn't perceive their audience as adults. Stan kind of did. I mean, on some level, he was writing for himself. And a lot of the winking and cleverness, you know, that he brought to it that I can appreciate now as an adult, I didn't see when I was 9 years old. It's really, it's almost impossible to describe, because it's like trying to describe a world in which there was only black and white television. You know, nobody can quite grasp that today. You know, you're sort of like, why would they, you know, how would that be, you know, or like I sometimes, you know, when I'm with my daughter, my younger daughter, you know, I'll say, you know, you live in a world in which you've never had access to a smartphone. You've never had immediate access to anything you want to see on TV. I grew up in a world in which when the phone rang, you had to answer it. There was no choice. You know, you had to answer that phone. If you wanted to watch a television show, you had to plan out your week so that you could see that show at a given time. And the odds of you seeing that episode again, you might luck out and see it again, you know, 6 or 8 months later when it was on reruns potentially. But in all likelihood, you'd never see it again. There's no way to really get that across, because we live in this world in which it permeates, you know, all of everything that we're talking about is based on a set of assumptions that literally did not exist 60 years ago. What was the world like before Stan Lee? It's impossible to say.
Yeah.
Do you think that the medium as it is would exist still today without Stan Lee? Like, would there be superhero comics without him? Like, or would it just the comics and that medium pass into kind of a specific type of art focus rather than a kind of broad consumer product?
I actually don't know how. It's hard to say. I mean, you can never completely give a definitive answer to a what if like that. But let's say that there had been no Marvel Revolution. I think DC would have still gone on. I don't know if there would have been a Batman show, because the Batman show in part was a response to the popularity of comics pop culture, you know, as a pop culture phenomena, which was driven by Marvel. There was an article in Esquire magazine, I think, in 1965 about Marvel Comics and its popularity on the popularity of the comics on college campuses. And it was sort of like, wow, this is a weird, freaky thing that's happening. So that put the idea of comics as a pop culture phenomenon into the air, which then led to the Batman show. I may have my timelines completely screwed up because I was a kid at that time, but I think that you can make an argument that Marvel's growing media presence led to things like the Batman TV show, which kept DC alive, which in turn, you know, made it a viable company up into the 70s when the Superman movie came out. And then the Superman movie kept comics alive until the Batman movie came out, and so on. Marvel didn't actually participate in that part of the media growth of comics, but it kept a viable art form during the period when studios were making decisions about what types of projects to embrace. It's just weird. I mean, I don't really know how to describe it, because again, it's a what if, and it's hard to really say. But without Stan, I think you would have just had more campy kind of superhero stuff. You know, like the Batman show would have been the attitude that you would have brought to superheroes, rather than Superman, the movie, which treated the character with respect and probably could only have happened because there was a growing sense that comics were worthy of respect.
I mean, when you talk about Stan and in these terms, I mean, you know, like obviously a big part of the success, in addition to the characters in the universe he created, was how Stan sold it, so to speak. You know what I mean? Like, and you know, before we get into Stan the salesman, I did want to talk a little bit about, because there's another thing from your essay, this idea of the real Stan, quote unquote. Because you had an interesting take on that, where, you know, it seems like, you know, who we saw in the media, it, at the end of the day, you seem to say it was the real Stan, and yet I feel like people have a hard time accepting that. they want to think that he's someone completely different when the cameras are not on, or when he's not talking to the press, or when he's not interacting with fans. I don't know what it is. What do you think it is? Where's the divide?
The truth is, he was a human being. You know, I mean, he was a person. He had a temper. You know, he could lose his temper. He wasn't always completely affable. He was a basically kind guy, I think, and I think honestly he meant well, but he could be selfish and he could be self-centered. But what he managed to do over the course of his lifetime was really become the person that he was portraying. You know, I mean, he could be petty, he could be mean-spirited. So can we all, you know? It's just whether you're aspiring to something that is better than that. And I genuinely think he did. You know, he was an interesting guy. What struck me most when I first met him was how much he was like the Stan of the letters pages, you know, the Stan of Stan's soapbox, this kind of affable, fast-talking caricature, you know, almost of a Madison Avenue type, you know. And I always wondered, you know, was there any there, you know? You could say it seems shallow, but I don't think it actually is. You know, I think it's if you're genuinely a pretty optimistic, happy guy, and it works for you, it has worked for you to be that guy in public, eventually that's just who you are, you know? So I think he was tickled pink by the fact that given how he was alienated from the business in his 30s, that all of that turned around, you know, and became a star, you know. And who thinks that things like that could happen to them? You know, you guys are both in your mid to late 30s, early 40s, right? I mean, just about. And just think about if you suddenly, you know, turned around tomorrow and podcasting made you a superstar, writing about you and wanting you to go to college campuses and talk about your podcasts. I mean, something that you just liked to do, that you were having fun doing, suddenly becoming, you know, a major social force. I mean, I think that would just blow yourself. Your self perspective completely out.
I think that's fair.
Mine is already blown out the window by the very fact that I get to talk to you on the show so frequently.
I've been fortunate in that I sort of dropped out of comics for a number of years and missed any real adulation from my 30s through my 60s, I guess. And as a result, I don't have a swelled head about any of this. So I'm always amazed that you guys want to talk to me. So, you know, I'm just happy to chat.
So speaking of which, you know, one of the things that, you know, I think fans and a lot of the articles I've been reading over the past week have kind of really seized upon when you're talking about is like that Stan kind of knew how much he was loved by fans and how much that kind of animated him. Can you speak to that? Do you have any understanding of like his kind of perspective in regards to his fans?
I hadn't really been in touch with Stan for the last 10 years or so. So I don't know how he felt about it, you know, since the Marvel movies started happening, which really put the whole thing on a whole nother level. You know, I know that he did have a sense of himself as a culturally important person. you know, back in the 70s, he tried to start up a local access cable TV show that he was the host of. And you don't do something like that unless you think that you have people who are interested in, you know, hearing what you have to say. So I guess he did know, you know, I mean, he certainly knew that when he went to conventions and to college campuses, that a lot of people wanted to hear him and wanted to talk to him. But I think he was also, you know, as I say, he's kind of surprised by all of it on a daily basis. You know, it's like you wake up every day and go, I am like the luckiest guy in the world. That's how I feel, you know, for myself. I'm amazed that stuff that I did when I was in my 20s, you know, has a social impact today. I mean, just flabbergasting to me. And I've got to think that unless he was a complete sociopath, which I don't think he was, Stan would have had a similar reaction.
You know, and I feel like even after his death, there was still talk of this, like at least like on Twitter and stuff. I mean, this idea that was his legacy complicated. I mean, and specifically as it relates to his relationship with the artists and getting credit and with, you know, specific and with Kirby and Ditko and sure. why do you feel that is a narrative that has taken hold? I feel more recently, like maybe the last decade or two. And I mean, is it Stan's fault? I mean, is it the way he's presented himself? Has this kind of been brought upon him? Or like, I'm just curious what your take is on that.
Well, I guess I guess because I never perceived that the artists didn't get credit, you know.
Yeah.
I mean, Stan, from the time that he first started giving credit in the books, always gave equal credit to the artists. You know, he called himself the writer and the artist, and there can be some debate, you know, over whether that was a fair assessment, but that was kind of the traditional way that you broke it down at that time. And he wasn't going to, and by the way, he gave Ditko credit for plotting Spider-Man. I mean, it's the thing that always frustrates me about the people who criticize on behalf of Jack and Steve Ditko in particular, is that there was some kind of assumption that these guys asked for things that Stan was unwilling to give them. You know, that Ditko wanted more credit and Stan said no. Well, that's not the case.
Yeah.
I mean, Ditko wanted credit for plotting and Stan gave him credit. It was right there. Kirby didn't want to be known just as the artist, so Stan started calling it a Stan Lee Jack Kirby production rather than, you know, Stan Lee writer and Jack Kirby artist. The real problem was that Stan was a very charismatic, very charming interviewee subject. You know, he was a guy who was very easy to interview, very, very pithy, quotable, fun, flattering to reporters, and reporters are lazy. they are not, they're not really, you know, they're not, many of them are working on a deadline and they're looking for a quick and easy way to sum up their story. And I know from reports that Jack Kirby in particular was seriously offended by the way that he was described in a story that came out in the late 60s. That he took to be Stan's fault, that you know, Stan should somehow have protected Jack from the way he was described as this kind of stogie chomping, blue collar craftsman rather than, you know, the genius that we know he was. Well, that is hardly Stan's fault. You know, I mean, the fact is that if I knew Jack, I actually probably knew Jack as well as I knew Stan. I worked with Jack in a couple of different circumstances, both at DC near the end of his run there and at Ruby Spears a few years later in animation. And Jack just could not communicate with other human beings. He couldn't do it. He was very smart, but he spoke elliptically. He, you know, went off on tangents. You know, he was so full of energy and ideas that getting him to say something that could be quoted would be almost impossible. Now, whose fault is that? That's not Jack's fault, and it's certainly not Stan's fault. But if you're a reporter and you're interviewing Stan and Jack, you're going to come away thinking that Stan is the guy who knows what's going on. That's just how it is. And did Stan take advantage of that? He may well have. But I also think that if either Jack or Steve had been willing to just address these issues with Stan, that he would have said, sure, you know, absolutely. Let me see what I can do to make this work better for you. That's my personal take on Stan. Stan never wanted to, in all my dealings with him, he never struck me as somebody who was like overly interested in taking all the credit for himself. Now, over time, I think that in response to some attacks that were made on him, he probably overestimated his own contribution to things. But I genuinely don't think that he, was trying to cut these other guys out. You know, when he said that he created the Fantastic Four, I think he honestly thought that he did. And I think, honestly, he did. Because you can take the Fantastic Four and compare that to, say, Challenges of the Unknown, which Jack Kirby created. And let's be honest, you know, I mean, Challengers is a fun book, but there's no characterization. There's no balance between the characters. You can't tell one from the other. You know, did Kirby say, hey, let's use the Human Torch? Kind of doubt it. You know, the Human Torch was a Marvel character, and Stan was probably looking around saying, what characters can we put in here? These are not characters that Jack Kirby would have created. You know, they're not as interesting as Kirby's own creations later were. You know, a stretchy guy, an invisible girl, a ripoff of Carl Burgos's Human Torch, and a pile of rocks, you know, that was like the monster that was in a Marvel monster book. That seems to me like a Stan Lee project. some of the stuff Stan created on his own in the 80s, you know, when he was doing things, they're not that imaginative. And the Fantastic Four isn't that imaginative. Neither is Spider-Man when you come right down to it. What's imaginative about it is in the writing and the execution. And to that degree, I think Jack and Steve, you know, raised the bar. And brought Stan up to a level where, you know, he had to write to what they were creating. But the initial impetus for these ideas, I honestly think probably was Stan. So in that sense, did he create them? Yeah, I think so. But, you know, we don't have time machines. We can't go back. We can't look over his shoulder and see. But you can sort of look at the material and say, this doesn't seem like a Jack Kirby project. You know, this seems like a Stan Lee half-assed put together, you know, kind of lame ideas, just as when he was working on his own later, that's what he did.
You don't love Stripperella?
Or look at the Just Imagine books. Remember the Stan Lee recreates Superman, Stan Lee. You know, there's something about that stuff that's just not that imaginative, you know? So yeah, the imaginative part of Marvel, I think, had a lot to do with Kirby and Ditko and their, what they brought to the table. But the impetus for some of these projects, I think, came from Stan. So in that sense, he created it, but he didn't create it by himself. And that's where I think he made a mistake in not giving them their full due for what they brought to the projects.
One of the things that I think there's no mistake about who created it is Marvel itself, like the idea of Marvel in pop culture, the idea of the bullpen and all of these other fantasies that Stan Lee created, including Stan himself, like as this pop culture character. Can you speak to, I mean, you worked there, as much of a there as there is. Like, can you speak to his creation of the idea of Marvel being like Marvel in general or whatever?
Well, that was a game changer. If you were a fan of DC Comics, you were a fan of specific editors at DC Comics. you weren't a fan of DC Comics as a group of books, you could love Julie Schwartz's books and not read a single other DC book. And in many cases, you didn't. You know, I mean, if you liked the Superman family, you probably didn't like the Batman family. You know, if you liked the war books, you didn't care about the superhero books. If you liked their TV comedy spinoff books, you know, you didn't care about anything except those books. So there was no there with DC Comics. What Stan did was interlock all these books, and he did it in a very specific way, you know, both by creating a world in which all these characters interacted, but also a meta world in which the creators interacted, you know, the bullpen, the Marvel bullpen, which was kind of lifted, I'm sure, from the EC Letters page. And the idea that, you know, there were creators behind the books. But EC never took it to the degree that Stan did. I mean, they came out with the Merry Marvel Marching Society, which I was a charter member of, was huge. I mean, it was a way to sort of participate with as a Marvel fan, you know, create yourself as a member of this group of people that were Marvel fans. And it came with a record, which if your membership kit came with a little record, a little plastic record that you had to put onto a 45 that you already owned and then put that onto your record player to play. And it kind of was scratchy and bumpy, but on it you had this tour of the Marvel offices where each of the creators said something, you know, so that they became real people. As I say, the reason that I have a career in comics is because there was a set of role models, you know, that were there for me to emulate, you know, comic book creators. And they were at DC, they were at Marvel. They weren't at DC, you know. Julie gave credit, started giving credit to some of his writers and artists on, you know, books like The Flash and Green Lantern and Atom. But for the most part, the books were written anonymously and you really didn't know who these people were. The Marvel story is that creation of a shared universe and a metaverse, you know, above that, you know, of creators, a company that you could pledge your allegiance to, to the Merry Marvel Marching Society.
Yeah.
Gerry, over the last week or so, I mean, what have you made to, I guess, the kind of the general reaction to Stan's death in the comics community, the fan community, the media? You obviously were able to express your thoughts on your blog, but I mean, from some of the other stuff you're seeing, I mean, are people getting it right, so to speak?
Yeah, I mean, Stan means things to different people, and he comes in different contexts. There are people like my daughter who was affected by Stan's death, even though she's never read a single comic that he wrote, or even actually read a Marvel comic. But she's a huge Marvel superhero movie fan. So her reaction to his death is that the guy who did who was in the cameos, you know, who was the voice of Marvel and the spiritual head of Marvel in some way, that mattered to her. You know, that was her personal reaction. Then you have the people who are thoughtful about it from a pop culture point of view. And they have their reaction, you know, which is similar to my own. You have people who worked with Stan, and we have our own, you know, personal reaction to him as a human being. There are very few people, you know, who literally change a culture, you know, and Stan actually did that. I put him up there with people like John Lennon, you know, I put him up there with artists like Pablo Picasso. I put him up there with Hemingway. Each of those people had an enormous influence within their sphere, but then that played out in a larger sense in the culture as a whole. Modern art, you know, affects everything in our culture in terms of design, fashion. You know, so Pablo Picasso has an effect that ripples beyond just Cubism. You know, it goes out onto everything. John Lennon, as a member of the Beatles, revolutionized how pop music expresses culture, you know, I mean, and reflects back on culture. Ernest Hemingway influenced an entire generation of writers, you know.
Yeah.
I mean, you can't, there isn't a writer alive today who doesn't have his roots, at least partially, in Hemingway. And Stan, you know, I think his impact spreads both through the comic book world and even our concepts of today of gender and heroism, you know, are influenced by Stan. You know, I mean, take cosplay as a simple example. The idea of grown adults dressing up outside of Halloween, you know, and then cross-dressing, you know, within that, that's a reflection of comic book culture, because those superheroes, I mean, if you just look at them as figures in, if they were real, say in the 1960s, if these characters were real, they would be really weird. You know, I mean, they're wearing these skin tight outfits that are very revealing, very sexualized, you know, in a way that the comic book characters from the 30s and 40s really weren't. And you're looking at them and you're going, whoa, you know, that, I mean, it's kind of, how do you separate that out from the sexual revolution in general? I don't know. It's part of the whole package. It's just real interesting. I think people will be writing about him for decades. We're not going to really have a perspective on Stan's impact on the culture for maybe 20 or 30 years.
Wow.
You know, just like we, when Dickens, I mean, people forget this now, you know, because Dickens is such a huge part of literary history. But Dickens was considered at the time this hack writer. He was a newspaper. He published newspapers with melodramatic stories that were serials that had no end. You know, I mean, just like comics today. But he transformed what we expect from fiction. You know, prior to that, fiction was supposed to be uplifting and, you know, the work of the for the elites, for poets, and you know, it was just something amorphous and transcendent. And people like Dickens brought it down to earth to the masses, and created literature as a part of pop culture. Stan has done that with comic books, and Bill Mayer notwithstanding, you can't say that's silly. It's really not, because pop culture is culture. You know, we may not always understand it, or you know, it's we may not always know why it's important, but it is the culture, and Stan was a premier figure of that culture for 50, 60 years.
It's so fascinating to me that, like, this big change came through what was considered, like, a low art form. And within his lifetime, you know, which was a rather long lifetime, he got to see himself validated and that art form validated in the form of how he always imagined it up on the big screen. Like, I couldn't... It's incredible to think about.
Well, yeah, but you know, every single major art form started off despised. I mean, you know, look at jazz, rock. I mean, we're talking about pop culture to a degree, but even art, you know, the idea of painting was originally commercial art. A lot, you had commercial art that was either for religious purposes, and then, you know, you painted for the church. That was it. You know, that was your choice. You could paint for the church or you didn't paint. But then around the 1600s, people started making enough money to hire artists to paint their pictures. You know, so we have Rembrandt, we had Vermeer, we had artists who suddenly went from being all about high art to commercial art. And those are now the artists that that then that leads, you know, ultimately on and on and on, you know, through progressive stages, you know, to art today, you know, which is totally commercialized, but still hugely influential. Animation, another form that started out as junk. And nobody would argue that the Pixar films aren't close to art. Stan took a form, a field that really was junk. It was junk, you know, it was supposed to be throwaway, disposable junk. And he elevated it just enough that people who came along after him were able to take it the rest of the way.
And now we spend, what, hundreds or thousands of dollars on that disposable junk from the 60s now?
Or fools us, but what are you going to do?
The reason it's so expensive is because it was disposable. There's so few left.
Yeah.
Well, Gerry, thanks again for coming on the show and talking to us about this. I think you provided some really awesome insights.
I'm always happy to chat, you know, and sometimes it makes sense. Glad you caught me on a good day.
We'll take it.
Yes.
Thank you, guys.
Hi, this is Angel from Puerto Rico. My only experience with Stan, we had a brief meeting with him, my wife and I, for a photo op in April of 2017 for Fan Expo Dallas. Photo ops move really quickly, so it's all fast. So I had my script ready. I was going to tell him, thank you for everything, but Spidey most of all. But when I got to him, I got flustered. And all I could get out was, hi, Stan, thank you for everything. Without missing a beat, he answered, you're welcome for everything. We took our picture, and we moved on. When they handed us our picture, I was like a kid again. It was an amazing moment. I'll be forever thankful to Stan for helping to create some of my favorite comic book characters. I'll always appreciate his sense of humor. He had a sense of humor about himself. He was self-deprecating. And I'll be grateful that he knew how much he meant to us. Thank you for everything, Stan. Rest in peace.
I'm going to miss Stan Lee. I'm going to miss him a lot because he basically created my childhood. I wouldn't be who I am without Stan. It's going to be a rough few days and maybe even months, but together as Spidey fans, I think we'll get through this and we'll allow Stan to live on through being fans.
Hey guys, it's Phil here from the RSRG Entertainment Podcast, and I just thought that I needed to call in and talk about my memories of Stan. Stan Lee is one of the greatest American icons to ever live. He's one of the greatest pop culture icons. He created my childhood, your childhood, and most of America's childhood, whether it be through his creation of Spider-Man, the Fantastic Four, his work on all of his awesome Marvel creations. Stan has really left a legacy for myself and more. My favorite Stan memory, or one of my oldest Stan memories, is the first time I read Amazing Fantasy 15. I remember as a kid someone giving me a copy to read in a reprint, and I was like, this is the greatest thing I ever read. And then hearing Stan's voice on the cartoon and ultimately seeing him show up in the amazing, in the Spider-Man cartoon in the animated series, Stan has always been part of my childhood, whether it be through cartoons, comics, his cameos in the movie. Stan has always been one to stand up for comics, and I'm so happy that he's had such an amazing life, but I'm so sad that we lost such an amazing creator, comics icon, and awesome, ultimately a man. Stan, you are the man. Excelsior.
Hey guys, it's been two days and it still hasn't sunk in. Stan was the man that you always thought that he would live forever. He always had a smile on his face and a story to tell. He raised us all, and thus it's like losing a family member. I don't want to say much, so Godspeed, my friend. Until we meet again, Excelsior.
Both Stan Lee and Steve Ditko were up there as far as that age, but, you know, losing both of them in the same year is still a really tough pill to swallow. To me, Stan Lee, he was a huge part of my childhood. Even though I think Steve Ditko, he brought a lot of the soul to the creation of Spider-Man, I think Stan brought the heart. With great power must also come great responsibility. That's a mantra that I try to aspire to every day of my life. It's why I chose to help others for a living. It's, I try to impart the same values to my son. Some say that Stan's greatest creation is Stan Lee, and I really do believe that. He gave men and women of all shapes and colors something to look up to, and that despite your flaws, you can still do good in this world. Rest in peace, Stan.
Hey, Dan and Mark. This is Jason from Montreal calling. Traveling the world, as usual, in my lovely job, which means I get to find out about all the news that's comic-related through Twitter and through social media. And, you know, I wanted to call, obviously, with what's just happened with the passing of Stan Lee. You know, a lot's going to be said from celebrities and people way more important than me on, you know, what this person had on the impact of the comic industry throughout his entire life. But, you know, if it wasn't for someone like Stan and his vision for our Marvel Universe, that all of us could enjoy and read stories that changed our lives and create podcasts to talk about these stories, and more importantly, to make friends along the way by reading his work. It's truly been a special journey for me, and I know for you guys. So anyway, just wanted to call in and say that Stan will live on forever, and my enjoyment of his characters will as well. So thanks, guys. Have a good show. Bye-bye.
Hey, Mark and Dan. It's Gavin from Indiana. I've been a fan of superheroes ever since I was a boy. And now that I'm a grown-up, I've been experiencing the comics from all different ages, and in particular kind of the ongoing Spider-Man books. And that's how I found your guys' show. And none of this stuff would be possible without Stan Lee. I've been a superhero fan, like I said, since I was a youngster. And then I've also grown up with the MCU movies, and my face just lights up every time I would see Stan's cameo. And it's going to be a whole lot different, a lot sadder now that we're not going to get those anymore. I've been working on a comic book of my own with one of my friends, and we're going to plan to launch that. And my inspiration is, you know, directly from people like Stan Lee, and then my friend the artist is definitely, you know, a Steve Ditko guy who also passed this year. It's just very sad to see that our great comic legends are leaving us, but they're not leaving us alone. They've left our these characters that we'll have for generations and generations to come.
You know, I guess one person can make a difference. Enough said.